Hello and welcome to Comic Culture. I'm Terrence Dollard, a professor in the Department of Mass Communication at the University of North Carolina at Pembroke. My guest today is writer-editor Paul Kupperberg. Paul, welcome back to Comic Culture.
Hi, Terrence. Nice to be here. Nice to be anywhere these days.
When we last spoke, we were talking about Charlton Neo and the work that you do there, but today we're going to talk about a different type of book, not a comic, but a book about writing comics, and I have a copy of it here. For those at home, it's called, and let me read, make sure I get it right, Paul Kupperberg's Illustrated Guide to Writing Comics. So, Paul, you've been writing comics for the better part of, well, I want to say close to 40 years. 45 years. So how do you distillate all of that knowledge into a book that's really concise and really good at teaching not only writing comics, but writing films, writing novels, just writing in general?
Well, first of all, story is story. It doesn't matter what form it takes. There's always beginning, middle, and end, if it's a TV show, a movie, a book, a short story, a comic book. So that's kind of basic. The rest, it's just kind of, hopefully I've learned how to write and how to do things like distill information down into a concise form. I've written in the past nonfiction books for the middle school library market. So I did all kinds of books on different nonfiction subjects, from everything from, astronaut biographies to the sinking of the Titanic to how to get a career as a rodeo cowboy. A rodeo clown.
Seriously?
There's more than that. Yes, I wrote a book. And it's, careers, whatever, and it was how to become a rodeo clown. So I'm prepared. So you just kind of, and I didn't just sit down and start from scratch to do this. A lot of the material I had already kind of laid out in columns and essays and things I've written over the years and just notes I've made. A lot of the information was just kind of there. And it was just a matter of, pulling it all together and giving it some shape.
One of the things that you mentioned is the young writer, and I see this a lot with my students. They have a really great idea, or so they think it's a really great idea for a story, whether it's a comic or a screenplay, but it's missing that one element, which is the human element. So can you kind of touch on the difference between plot versus story?
Well, plot is what happens and story is why. I mean, it's really that simple. Example I used in the book was that this guy at a signing came up to me and was excited and telling me the plot of his comic book that he was working on. And I said, "That's great, what's the story?" And he started repeating the plot. I said, "No, what's it about? Who's this guy? Where did he come from? What's it happening to him? Is he angry? Is he scared? Is he, just ask the basic questions about character and story, because story comes out of character. You can't just take a generic story and fit a specific character in it. In comic books, a Superman story doesn't work for Batman. An Aquaman story doesn't work for Wonder Woman. So you have to tailor it to your character. So it's just a matter of finding out what. I've heard people describe it as saying, just ultimately, what does your character want? That's it. That's your goal. That's what you're after. You have to figure that out. And once you know where they want to be, you have to figure out how to, how to take them along and get there.
And it's interesting because you mentioned in the book, you did some writing for Archie Comics, and you talked about how you wanted to write Reggie Mantle in a way that would, sort of strip his dignity, but you found that the character, it was impossible for you to do that because of the way the character was constructed. So is this something, again, that kind of works with the story of what the character wants and how that fits into the plot?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I could have written Reggie getting, taken down in these stories and have him, disrespected and not treated well. But when I wrote that, it just wasn't right. I finished the scene and it's like, I couldn't figure out how he'd respond even. I just didn't know, So I just decided that, this guy, there was more to the character. It's funny, you read these guys, I've been reading Archie comics for, nigh on to 60 years now. And the characters are so, you know, inside me. I've absorbed them so much that when I sat down to write them, I just kind of got it. You know, it's like I knew that, you know, Archie is this guy who's so desperate to be helpful, he'll trip over himself and you know, and destroy everything. But he's trying to please everybody. You know, he's the good guy. Jughead is the smartest guy in town. He just doesn't show it, you know, but he's great at manipulating people. And, you know, so you pick up these clues about the characters and you write little stories about them. You know, I wrote a story, not in the life of Archie, but in the regular teenage Archie story, where Jughead and Ronnie are at the mall and they're, you know, just sniping at each other because that's what they do. But when push comes to shove and Ronnie's accused of shoplifting or something, you know, Jughead jumps to her defense because this is his friend. He knows her. She wouldn't steal. And she, you know, is not surprised that Jughead was back at having her back. That's who these characters are. And once you learn, again, what do these characters want? Well, you know, in the storyline I was working on, Reggie wanted his dignity. You know, he was this guy who would, it was the Life with Archie storyline. And he was, you know, grown up out of college and all his friends were kind of on their way to doing something. And he was just drifting. He didn't know where he was going. And all he wanted was a direction. So, you know, my job as the writer of the story was to, you know, push him off and get him going in that direction.
You're dealing with characters, like you said, you've been reading for most of your life and you kind of have a sense of who they are. But I guess because, you know, we generally tend to think of things as entertainment, we don't necessarily absorb all the nutrients of the story and understand the characters the same way that you have to as a writer. So is this something that maybe when you are coming onto the book, maybe you talk to the editor just to kind of get a sense of what they're looking for and then, you know, kind of see how that maybe can put those pieces together in your head?
Well, for Archie, it was a little easier because I kind of had a model to work off of before the Life with Archie the magazine started. There was the 6-issue Archie Loves Betty, Archie Loves Veronica storyline in Archie Comics starting at number 600 that Michael Uslan had set up. So I kind of had a blueprint to work from on that. But, you know, walking into a character is kind of the job. You know, I've been doing that my whole life. You know, someone says, you want to do a Doctor Who story? Yeah, I'll do a Doctor Who story. I never watched Doctor Who, but I learned what I needed to know about Doctor Who to write a story. And nobody came back to me afterwards and said, you had no clue what you were doing, did you? You know, so the only time I've ever been stymied was the Lone Ranger. Could not get a bead on the Lone Ranger. Just there was nothing there for me to grasp. But otherwise, it's like you go in, you watch, you know, I'm currently writing a Kolchak the Night Stalker prose story. So I sat down and watched another episode or two, you know, just to kind of familiarize myself with his speech patterns and things like that. But, you know, it's the job.
One of the things that your book does touch on, and what a brilliant segue you provided me with, was the shift from fan to pro. And you talk about some of the behaviors that you need to have as a professional versus like me. I, you know, might make some comics at home on the weekend, but I'm not ready to send my submission out to a publisher. So if I'm looking to be a professional writer, what sort of discipline, what sort of approach should I take when I'm looking at that blank page?
Well, you know, you just have to do it. You know, put a word on there. You know, find a word, start it. Write page one, panel one, and then just start, you know, something. You know, you shouldn't be sitting down to write a story without knowing where it's going to begin with. But, you know, it's just do it. Just sit down and do it. Find the story. Find a story you want to tell. Back when I started writing comics in the mid-70s, you didn't really have to have anything to say. You know, it helped. I mean, you know, the guys like Steve Gerber and Steve Englehart and, you know, anybody else named Steve, they, you know, they had stories to tell and they had points to make. A lot of us were just writing comic book stories. You know, there's an inherent message in any comic book story, you know, well, in any superhero comic book story, you know, good versus evil, that message is always there. But as a fan, you can kind of, you approach this material as the fantasy, you know, you're on the outside of the fantasy looking in, and you know, and you see this, you know, social media is great to observe this. You see the fans speculating or you know, letting everybody else know what they would like to see coming up in these books or in these comics or these movies. Most of it is just, you know, impractical for reasons that they just don't know about because, you know, they don't do this for a living. You know, their speculation on why things are done was like, you know, did you plan this or not? No, I just happened to notice that, you know, 12 issues earlier I did this thing, so I picked up on it and it just looked like I planned it. I mean, that's how it works. That's how long-form storytelling works. You know, there's always an assumption that what you've done is based on something that's come before. You know, it's like, oh, is this based on the, which version? No, I made it up, you know? So fans, you know, they can focus on the fantasy part. The writer also focuses on the fantasy part, but he has to be realistic about it. You know, the writer has to deal with the fantasy and has to make it realistic. You know, whether you're doing, you know, Game of Thrones or you know, a detective noir story set in the real world, you still have to make it believable. You have to believe those dragons and those, you know, and that magic. You can't just apply this generic story to it. You have to make it real. You have to make it believable. So, you know, we're stuck with that problem. You know, the fans hate what you do because they know what they want you to have done. But if you do what they want you to have done, they are like, yeah, I knew you were going to do that. It's a weird situation to be in. You're just kind of, you're fulfilling their fantasy. So that puts you in a precarious position.
And it's, I think someone once said, you know, I can give you what you want or I can give you what you'll enjoy or something along those lines. You know, I might want, you know, Spider-Man to win a lottery, but that's going to fundamentally change, you know, Peter Parker, right, the character as he's constructed. And I guess that would lose his appeal.
Whenever the characters get happy, you know, things are going well, it gets really dull. So you have to jump in and screw up their lives again. Happy isn't interesting. So, you know, you can't leave the characters in a good place. Otherwise, who cares?
And speaking of cares, I mean, you started your career in comics as a fan, and you wrote stories that were of the time, of that style of comics, and your work has evolved over the years. And I'm wondering, at what point did you start to maybe think of, you know, a Clark Kent in Superman family story differently than maybe something you did long form in, you know, your run on the Doom Patrol or in Checkmate?
Yeah, I don't know. When I was doing Superman, it was, you know, a pre-crisis. And up till then, you know, this was Julie Schwartz's Superman, which I loved, you know, he took over the book in, what, 1970? You know, so I grew up in the 60s on the silly Mort Weisinger stories, you know, Superman fighting gangsters in suits, while over in Batman, he was fighting aliens and mad scientists. You know, it was just a topsy-turvy world back then. Julie's stories could be silly. You know, I mean, there was a large component of silliness to a lot of the stories. You know, you could overcome it after a while, after you'd been working for him for a while. He'd let you do stories that, you know, didn't contain that, you know, those elements. I mean, I love that stuff, and I'm not apologizing for any of it that I wrote. I got to write Superman, so you know, great, awesome. After that, you know, just you felt the business shift. You know, that was kind of like the death knell of the Silver Age silliness. You know, nobody was doing that anymore. Julie had been kind of the last of those guys. So once I started doing things like, you know, Vigilante and Doom Patrol, you're propped up by the fact that it's Superman. You know, and I was writing a lot of Superman in the early 80s. I was writing Supergirl, Superboy, a large portion of the Superman and Action Comics and DC Comics Presents, as well as the syndicated Superman newspaper strip. So I was, you know, Superman up to here. But you've always got that backup with Superman. He's Superman. You know, you need a story? Well, he can do anything. You know, it doesn't matter. You can take it as far as you want. You get down to these, you get back to these more down-to-earth characters. Even Doom Patrol are, you know, infinitely more down to earth than Superman. It's a different matter. You can't rely on the mythos anymore. You know, certainly not in, you know, when I got to vigilante. You know, that was just you have to have something to say when you're writing those stories. If you're just writing stories about a guy who goes out bashing bad guys, you know, you got the Punisher. But, you know, you can't do that. This guy, you know, I started writing it with kind of a superhero mindset to it. And then I realized, no, this isn't an altruistic superhero. This guy's insane. Even though Adrian Chase was presented as this, you know, cool, sober judge, you don't conceive the idea of putting on a costume and killing people. You know, that's not the thought of a rational mind. So this guy, you know, I kind of at some point I realized, you know, it's going to end badly, and it is going to end. This is a character that can't sustain itself, you know. At some point, he has to pay for it. So, you know, that's heavy, you know. That and now he's telling stories. You're telling stories about real people. You're dealing with real situations. It's not guys in costumes zapping each other over, you know, the secret orb. It's about child molesters and rapists and drug dealers and you know, all kinds of in the gutter stuff. So, you know, it was at that point where I kind of went, it wasn't a conscious effort, but it was just like time to grow up and time to tell more grown-up stories.
And, you know, you talked about the great Julie Schwartz, and I will say that whenever I go to a convention, one of the things I do is long box dive for the classic late 70s, early 80s Superman, the pre-crisis Superman. And you did that great run on Supergirl. But let's talk about the editor's role a little bit. You mentioned in your book that you had been working on a book, and Joe Kubert ended up becoming the editor, and he gave you some advice about this magical character to use less magic. So how does some advice like that actually help the writer?
It was Arion, Lord of Atlantis, and Joe replaced the previous editor who had replaced me as writer on the book that I had created for reasons we need not go into, but were not my fault. But Joe was handed the book, you know, Joe being a guy who believes that creators should do what they create, got me back on the title. I do the first couple of issues for him, and he calls me and says, you know, I think there's just too much magic in this book. I'm like, you mean there's too much magic in this comic book about this Atlantean sorcerer? You know, it's like I didn't. And he goes, yeah, too much magic. Just cut back on the magic. Let's you know, get rid of the magic for a while. And it was one of these, you know, kind of like cryptic editorial instructions. But when I sat down to do it, I realized what Joe was talking about, that I was using the magic as a crutch. Arion can just wave his hands and do whatever and, you know, hocus pocus, he's out of trouble. That's easy. You know, that's the ultimate nullifier effect, I call it. You know, when you can't defeat the Galactus, you realize, oh, wait, there's this ultimate nullifier that can defeat anything. Let's just go get it.
If you have that crutch, the magic wand that can solve all problems, right, it makes it easier for you not to solve them.
That's right. You don't have to solve them. You just have to do a spell. So take that away. Now he's got to deal with things like everybody else with, you know, fist and sword or you know, discussion and negotiation. You know, so it did make a big difference. I mean, eventually the magic came back, but now I had learned how not to mess with it. And Joe, being, you know, brilliant, was able to deduce that after a few scripts. So
let's talk a little bit about writing, I guess, the action descriptions. It's one thing you mentioned in your book about the Marvel style, which I guess is, you know, Stan Lee talking to an artist, maybe playing out how a scene's going to go and then saying, okay, deliver the pages and he'll write the copy. But DC was always known as having more of a scripted format, because you might not know who the artist is on the book that you're writing. So when you're writing, do you kind of like say, well, if it's Kurt Swan, I'm going to write it this way and hope that it's Kurt? Or if I get Jose Luis Garcia Lopez, I'm going to hope that he can interpret whatever I'm writing and make it as brilliant as they can?
I kind of learned to write kind of generic. I leave it to the, you know, I give as much information as the artist needs to set the scene. I don't tell them how to set, you know, how to shoot it, unless I need a specific angle for, you know, a very specific story reason. I don't tell them how to draw. I just tell them what I need in the panel, and I leave it up to them to you know, bring that in there. Guys like, you know, Kurt, you know, boy, what, you know, I was just going to say, what couldn't he draw? But my next point was, if I knew Kurt was going to draw a script, I wouldn't do monsters from outer space and aliens, because Kurt drew the most ridiculous aliens and monsters ever. I mean, he just never got the hang of that. He was so, his stuff was so grounded in realism that his aliens were just, you know, goofy and laughable. They look like something out of, you know, Kukla, Friend, and Ollie. You know, but then every now and then you get a surprise. You know, I turned in one script, which was just written with, you know, my usual generic panel description, and the art comes in and Julie shows it to me, and it's Gray Morrow. So, you know, you never knew.
Now, I see we have about 5 minutes left in our conversation. I wanted to talk about the process that you went through, and I'm gonna hold the book up again for our folks at home. The process that you went through to get these books printed and published. You went through Kickstarter and did crowdsourcing to get this done. So I'm wondering, how do you approach a campaign to reach out to as many people as possible, but also appeal to folks who might have supported some other campaigns and get this book so that everyone can read it?
I'm probably horrible at Kickstarter. I mean, you know, it did well, but I see other people, yeah, well, it depends on the book. I mean, you know, some books can bring in tens of thousands of dollars and I did okay. I did, you know, like 300% of my goal, which is, you know, very nice and very gratifying. I'm very happy for that. I'm sure there are ways to push it harder, and I should learn them, because, you know, crowdsourcing is kind of becoming, unfortunately, the way to books are getting distributed these days. You know, I'd love to just be able to use it as a kind of a jumping off point, knowing that I could other outlets sell the book. But, you know, for a large part, a lot of your circulation is the Kickstarter backers. You know, it is available on Amazon and you know, I offered copies direct as well, signed. It's weird for me, because I'm used to old school publishing, you know, where it was just, you hand the book to a publisher, and the next thing you know, you get a copy, and you know, and they give you money. You know, it doesn't cost you money. You know, I've got one going now for another book that's about writing. It's called I Never Write for the Money, But I Always Turn in the Manuscript for a Check, and it's a collection of edited and revised columns and essays I've written over the years about writing and having written and you know, everything in between. But, you know, again, the campaign is going well, and I'm always gratified. Like I say, you know, I told you before we started going that, you know, I never expect to reach my initial goal. So anytime I go past it, it's great. It's very gratifying. But, you know, it's a new world. You know, we've got bookstores dying to begin with, and now you top it with COVID, you know, which is going to kill even more. We're adapting.
I just wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, social media. You're on social media. You've got, I'm sure, the Twitter and the Facebook accounts. So when you're reaching out to folks about the Kickstarter, is this something that you're kind of like hoping that you've cultivated a big enough group? Or is it something where, you know, it's just, you're Paul Kupperberg, darn it, and everybody should be aware that you've got this great career and a lot to say about comics?
I leave that for other people to say. my point, you know, I just try to get it out as much as possible. I mean, with this current one, we put together a 60-page free downloadable digital comic book sampler, 8 stories of mine, that you can get just for checking out the Kickstarter campaign. You know, you click a button, you share information about the campaign on your Facebook page, and then you get a downloadable comic book. So, you know, no purchase necessary. You know, so we're trying to attract people that way, just, you know, get people, give them something for helping you out, you know, say thank you for helping spread the word.
Well, Paul, I've been told that we're just about out of time. I'd like to thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule to talk with me. If there's a way that people can find out more about the work that you've got on Kickstarter, where can they find that?
On Kickstarter itself. You can also, I'm on Facebook and Twitter under, you know, Paul Kupperberg. So you can follow me there, and I am relentless and annoying in posting about it. And, you know, but try to be entertaining in the process.
Well, Paul, I find you to be entertaining on social media, and I'd like to thank you for taking time out to talk with me today. I'd like to thank you at home for watching Comic Culture. We will see you again soon. Comic Culture is a production of the Department of Mass Communication at the University of North Carolina at Pembroke.